that Allah gave you life, when you didn't have life, then he caused you to die. Then again he'll give you life, and to him will you return. Every soul shall have a taste of death, but the final recompense will be on the day of judgment. And anyone who is saved from the hellfire and enters Jannah, the garden, he has achieved the objective of this world. For this life is nothing but mere chattels of plain amusement. That even if you say that I believe in God, do you think Allah will not test you? You are bound to be tested. Every human being is bound to be tested, Allah says. If we go back to our scriptures and follow the established truth of the scriptures, believing in one God, believing in the final messenger, believing life after death, inshallah, India will be a superpower. There are various places in the Hindu scripture where liquor has been prohibited, including Manusmriti, chapter number 9, verse number 225, Manusmriti, chapter number 7, verse 47, Manusmriti, chapter number 7, verse number 50, Rigved, book number 8, hymn number 2, verse number 12, Rigved, book number 8, hymn number 21, verse number 14. In several places, alcohol, liquor has been prohibited in the Hindu scriptures. Now, second point, mentioned Surah Maida, chapter number 5, verse number 90 was, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, innamal khamru wal maisuru, most certainly intoxicants and gambling. Hindu scriptures even prohibit gambling. If you read Rigved, book number 10, hymn number 34, verse number 3, it says a gamester, a gambler, he says that his wife leaves him aloof. His mother hates him. And he says that no one comforts this wretched man. And after a few verses, Rigved, book number 10, hymn number 34, verse number 13, it says that do not play with dice. Rather, cultivate the land. And whatever you earn, be satisfied with that earning. Gambling has also been prohibited in Manusmriti, chapter number 7, verse number 50. It says, drinking, gambling, women, and hunting. All these are four major sins in order. Drinking alcohol has also been prohibited in Manusmriti, chapter number 7, verse number 47. In Manusmriti, chapter number 9, verse number 221 to 228. It's also prohibited in Manusmriti, chapter number 9, verse number 258. The third thing, well, anzabu al-azamu, dedication of stones, divination of arrows. Idol worship we already discussed earlier. Divination of arrows, fortune telling. It's mentioned in Manusmriti, chapter number 9, verse number 258, that a person who earns his living by telling good things, a soothsayer and a fortune teller, Manusmriti chapter 9, verse 262 says that the king shall punish them according to the severity of the crime. So even fortune telling and soothsaying have been prohibited in Manusmriti chapter number 9, verse number 258 to 262. Quran further says in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 188. Quran prohibits bribing. Quran says, use not your wealth as a bait for the judges, in order you may eat other people's wealth. Quran prohibits involving in bribe. The same thing is mentioned in Manusmriti, chapter number 9, verse number 258. It says that a person who deals with bribe, a deceiver, a defaulter, all of them, verse 262 says that the king shall punish them according to the severity of the sin. Furthermore, Quran prohibits the eating of pork in no less than four different places. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 173, Surah Maida, chapter number 5, verse number 3, Surah Anam, chapter number 6, verse number 145, and Surah Nahl, chapter number 16, verse number 115, Hurrimat alaykumul maitutu waddamu walahmul khinzir, wama uhilla li ghairil bi. Forbidden for you for food are dead meat, blood, the flesh of swine, and any food on which any name besides Allah's name is invoked. Quran prohibits, besides other thing, the eating of the flesh of swine. Pork has been prohibited. Pork has also been prohibited in the Hindu scriptures. It's mentioned in the Manusmriti, chapter number 5, verse number 19. It says that a Brahmin, knowingly, if he eats mushroom, if he eats dung heap pig, if he eats onion, a tame cock, or garlic, he shall fall. It's further mentioned in the Vishnu Sutra, chapter number 5, verse number 49, that anyone who sells pork should be punished in the same way. Anyone who sells the forbidden meat, including pork, he should be punished in the same way. That means his opposite hands and legs should be lopped off. The Vishnu Sutra, chapter number 5, verse number 49 says, if anyone sells pork, the punishment for him is chopping off his opposite hands and feet. Even this punishment is not mentioned in the Quran. So the Hindu scriptures are more against not having the flesh of pork as compared to Islamic scriptures. There are many misconceptions in Islam, and people always point a finger that why does Islam subjugate the woman by keeping her in the veil? And if we analyze that, who is to decide what is modest? The Quran says in Surah Nur, chapter number 24, verse number 30, say to the believing man that he should lower his gaze and guard his modesty. That whenever a man looks at a woman, any brazen thought comes in his mind, he should lower his gaze. Next verse, Surah Nur, chapter number 24, verse number 31 says, say to the believing woman that she should lower her gaze and guard her modesty, and display not her beauty except what appears ordinary of, and draw her veil over the bosom, and display not her beauty except in front of her father, her husband, her son, then a big list of mahram is given. Basically, there are 6 criteria for hijab, which is given in the Quran and the Hadith. The first is the extent. For the man, it's from navel to the knee. For the woman, the complete body should be covered. The only part that can be seen are the face and hands up to the wrist. There are many scholars who say that even this should be covered. The remaining 5 criteria are the same. The second is the clothes they wear, it should not be tight so that it reveals the figure. Third, it should not be transparent. Fourth, it should not be so glamorous so that it attracts the opposite sex. Fifth, it should not resemble and be a sign of the unbeliever. And sixth, it should not resemble that of the opposite sex. Similarly, if you read Hindu scriptures, it's mentioned in Rig Veda, book number 8, hymn number 33, verse number 19. It says, Brahma has made you a dame, made you a lady. So therefore, cast down your eyes and do not look up. Put your feet together and let not your garment reveal what your veil conceals. So according to Rig Veda, book number 8, hymn number 33, verse number 19, it says that the woman should lower the gaze. They should not stare at the opposite sex, and they should wear a veil. Further, it's mentioned in Rig Veda, book number 10, hymn number 85, verse number 30, that it is devilish and not right when a husband, he covers his thighs with the garments of his wife. That means wearing clothes of opposite sex is prohibited in Hinduism. It's further mentioned in Mahavir Charit, Act number 2, page number 71, when Sri Ram, when he sees Parushuram, he tells his wife Sita that Parushuram, he is our elder. You cast thy eyes and draw the veil. So Sri Ram tells his wife Sita that when the elder comes, you should draw the veil and look down. Further, if you read the books of historical records, we find the Indian ladies, many of them wear veils. There are coins in the post-Gupta age showing women, Indian women, wearing a veil and the veil coming up to the shoulders, some up to the arms. Even today, if you go in many Indian villages, we find that women, they cover the head. Some of the women cover their face. So here, if you analyze the modesty level of a woman in Islam and Hinduism, is the same, that they have to be covered up. Furthermore, people talk about that why does Islam allow a man to have more than one wife. In fact, if you analyze most of the major scriptures, they permit a man to marry as many wives as they wish. If you read Ramayana, the father of Ram, King Dashrath, he had 3 wives. If you read the Vishnu Sutra, chapter number 24, verse number 1, it says a Brahman can have 4 wives. If you read Mahabharata, Krishna had how many wives? 4? 10? 1,000, 10,000, Krishna had 16,108 wives. So when Krishna can have 16,108 wives, so why can't we Muslims have at least 4? Quran says in Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 3, marry women of a choice in 2s, 3s, or 4s, but if you can't do justice, marry only one. In Islam, you're allowed to marry 2, 3, or 4, but if you can't do justice, you can only marry one. But if you can do justice, the maximum you can marry is only 4. You cannot marry beyond that. And the reason why Islam allows polygamy, you can refer to my video cassette, Women's Rights in Islam. In the conclusion of my talk, I would like to mention that if we analyze from history, that the Britishers, when they came to India, the Western philosophy, it influenced the Indian culture. And because of that, the Indian culture was going down. And towards the starting of the 19th century, we have several Hindu reformers. The pioneer amongst them is Raja Ram Mohan Roy, who was born in Bengal in 1772. He learned English, Arabic, and Persian. And he wrote a book in 1803, which spoke against idol worship. He believed in the philosophy of the Upanishads, that believed in universalism of Upanishad, and he said that Almighty God is one. He has got no images. He spoke against idol worship and said Almighty God did not have avatars. He cannot become a human being. He even spoke against caste system. And when he formed his trust, the Brahmo Samaj, he mentioned his trust deed. He mentioned the trust deed that no graven image, no carving, no sculpture, no statue, no picture, no portrait will enter in this building. And there were many offshoots of Brahma Samaj, but all of them believe in the same philosophy, God is one, God has got no images, idol worship is wrong, God does not become avatar. They were against the caste system. As far as the cycle of samsara was concerned, it was optional. You want to follow, follow, don't want to follow, don't follow. One among the offshoot of Brahma Samaj was Prarthana Samaj, which was founded by Justice Zanade. Justice Zanade in Bombay founded the Prarthana Samaj, and there he followed all these principles but was strictly for the upliftment of the woman and said that the woman should be educated, and a woman who becomes a widow, she should remarry. The other great reformer that we had was Swami Dayananda Saraswati, who founded the Arya Samaj in 875. He believed strictly in the Vedas, and he said that the Hindus should follow only the Vedas. And he strictly said that God is one. God has got no images. He spoke against idol worship. He said God Almighty doesn't have avatars. The other great reformer that most of us are aware is Swami Vivekananda, who founded the Ramakrishna Mission. And he too spoke that we should follow the Vedas. And he said, though 99% of the Vedas have been lost, today we have only 1% of the Vedas, which cannot be accommodated even in a large hall. But he said that we should not call ourselves Hindus, we should call ourselves Vedantists, follow the Vedas. Now if we analyze that the Britishers came a few centuries ago to India to do business, but unfortunately they looted our country and they had the policy of divide and rule. And they saw to it that there were differences between the Hindus and Muslims so that they could rule. And they even corrupted many of the Indian culture. Because of that, Hinduism went down. And that's the reason that in the early part of the 19th century, there was a surge of Hindu reformers, like Raja Ram Mohan Roy, like Justice Zanade. Whatever I spoke in my talk, all have been picked up from these great scholars. I am just a student of comparative religion. All these things I've spoken of Hinduism is not my own invention. All these have been picked up from these great Hindu reformers, like Raja Ram Mohan Roy, like Justice Zanade. I have only, as a student of comparative religion, I verified it. And what I did, whatever they spoke, the references weren't given. I went to the Hindu scriptures and I gave the references. Only thing I did was I did the references, nothing else. And all the things I mentioned about Hinduism, it was always backed up with quotation from the Vedas and the other Hindu scriptures. I'm aware Vedas are the most authentic. But the reason I've given quotation from the other scriptures also, because many Hindus, those who believe only in Vedas, even if they remove all the other quotations besides the Vedas, yet my talk will be 100% the same. But there are many Hindus, though they respect the Vedas, but they are more well aware of Bhagavad Gita and the Puranas. So because of that, I've quoted these scriptures also so that they can come closer to the Vedas and come closer to the concept which is established in the Hindu scripture.
Assalamu alaikum.
My name is Othman Barry.
My name is Ahmed Nasser.
My name is Zaid Adib Ansari.
My name is Tariq Khalid.
Alive before the Islam, we were Christian.
From falsehood to truth.
The reason that I accept Islam was I was looking for the truth.
What's the meaning of life?
These answers I didn't find Christianity.
From unfairness to justice.
The Muslims had a solution to these problems, but through their understanding of the Quran.
My life before Islam was typically an American life looking for purpose in life.
From chaos to peace.
Peace TV is playing a very important role in promoting Islam.
Meet the people who have given up their ill fates to come out from the clutches of complete darkness in From Darkness to Light every Friday at 4:30 p.m. Saudi Arabia and 5:30 p.m. UAE on Peace TV.
A friendly message by Dr. Zakir, mother of all evils.
According to the World Health Organization, every year, millions of people die due to the consumption of alcohol. My colleagues, the medical doctors, nowadays say that alcoholism is a disease. Therefore, we have to be sympathetic towards a sick alcoholic person. If alcoholism is indeed a disease, then it is the only disease that is sold in bottles. It is the only disease that is advertised in the newspapers, in the magazines, on radio broadcast stations, on television satellite channels. It is the only disease that has outlets licensed to legally spread it. It gets a revenue for the government. It is the only disease that causes violent deaths on the highways. It destroys family life and increases crime. It is the only disease that has no germs or viral cause. But our Creator, the Almighty, says in His last testament, the glorious Quran, in Surah Maida, chapter number 5, verse number 90, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amun, O you who believe, innamal khamru wal maisuru, most certainly intoxicants and gambling, wal ansabu wal azlam, dedication of stones, divination by arrows, Rijsum min amali shaitan. These are an abomination of Satan's handiwork. Fajtanibuhu lallakum tuflihun. Abstain from such abomination that you may prosper. Alcoholism is not a disease. It is Satan's handiwork. Abstain from it that you may prosper.
Peace TV, the solution for humanity.
The Britishers, they had the policy of divide and rule. And unfortunately, even I fell prey to that. I thought, how could Hinduism have similarity with Islam? Impossible. After reading books of these great scholars, these great reformers, and doing research, that's how this talk has come about. But the main reason that these Britishers, they had the policy of divide and rule, our country has got the freedom from the Britishers, but unfortunately yet, we are slaves to the policy of divide and rule. And unfortunately, most of our Indian politicians, if not all, most of them, they follow the same rule of divide and rule to get their votes. India is the country in the world which has the maximum number of rights. Every day we have more than one right on average. And if you go to the background of these rights, almost all of these rights have been engineered by politicians for the vote bank. There was somebody who told me that the politicians, they add fuel to the fire. I told them, no, he's wrong. I don't agree that the politicians add fuel to the fire. The politicians, they add fire to the fuel. The fuel, most of the time, is constructive. You know, the vehicles run with fuel, factories are working, the fuel makes the construction of a country. They add fire to it and they cause destruction of the country. There was an article that came last month in Times of India in Bombay. It says that according to Japan, in the next 20 years, India will be the superpower of the world. We know that before the Britishers came to India India was a superpower. Now, if all the Indians, all the Hindus, and all the Muslims, if we go back to our scriptures and follow the established truth of the scriptures, believing in one God, believing in the final messenger, believing in life after death, inshallah, India will be a superpower. Only if all the Indians, the Hindus and the Muslims, if you go back to the scripture and follow the scriptures, we'll be a superpower, we'll be far superior to the Americans, far superior to America and the European countries, inshallah. It is clearly mentioned in the Vedas. Rig Veda tells us in book number 10, hymn number 71, verse number 4, seeing the words they see not, hearing the words they hear not. You see it's mentioned in the scripture so clearly, yet you see not. You hear the words of the scripture, yet you hear not. Same thing the Quran says in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 44. You study the scripture, yet you don't follow it. Allah says in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 18, summum bukmun umyun fam la arjun, the deaf, the dumb, the blind, they will not know the true path. We feel and we see that most of the religious leaders of most of the major religions, whether it be Islam, Christianity, or Hinduism, they prevent their followers from reading the scripture with understanding. For their own ulterior benefits. Because if the followers read the scriptures, then maybe they will not be able to get their ulterior benefits. I have given a talk earlier on the topic, Al-Quran, should it be read with understanding? If we understand Quran, the best way to understand is to learn Arabic as a language. If you cannot learn Arabic as a language, read the translation of the Quran in the language you understand the best. And we have the Quran translated in the major languages of the world. Similarly, if you analyze that though there are many sects in Islam, there are many sects, but the differences that are there in the sects are very small, are very minute, they are negligible. The major factor of all these sects of Islam, they are the same, that Almighty God is one, that the Quran is the same, that the Messenger Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is the same. Because the reason is the language in which the Quran was revealed, the last and final revelation, the glorious Quran, the language was Arabic, and today yet Arabic is a living language. That's the reason William Moore, Sir William Moore, was a staunch critic of Islam, yet he mentioned that the book that has maintained purity in the past 12 centuries, he said 200 years ago, is the glorious Quran. Because it was revealed in a language, Arabic, which is a living language. My request to the Indian government and to my dear Hindu brothers and sisters is that you should revive Sanskrit. It's my humble request to the Indian government and my Hindu brothers and sisters. You learn Sanskrit, go back to your scriptures, go back to your Vedas, and realize that God is one. You understand that God has got no images. You understand God has got no avatar. You should understand and realize who is the last and final messenger. You should understand this life is a test for the hereafter. And then only we Muslims, the Hindus can come together and build a great Indian nation. I would like to end my talk with the quotation of the glorious Quran of Surah Yunus, chapter number 10, verse number 108. Ya ayyuha nas, say, O humankind, truth has arrived from your Lord. Those who receive guidance, they do good for their own souls. And those who go astray, they do it at their own loss. I have not been set up as a manager of affairs over you. Wa akhir da'wan alhamdulillah rabbil alameen.
Jazakallahu khair, Dr. Zakir Naik, for this enlightening talk on the subject, similarities between Hinduism and Islam. We now begin the question and answer sessions, and can we have the first question from the brother on my left?
This soul's name is Yogananda. This opportunity this soul takes to pay the thanks to Almighty Allah. For today, peace to humanity has been seeded through Dr. Zakir Naik. Peace to humanity for the Hindu-Muslim unity. So, thanks very much for your very great effort he has taken by going through all the Vedas and other things, really big task he has done. But still more is the another part of in Hinduism, that is, he has touched the matter of Vedanta. There is Siddhanta, is another one is there. That also, if he concentrates, still more he can give very good evidences, and it will be very good for the peace to humanity for the future. Okay, thank you very much. Thanks a lot.
I'm thankful to the brother's comment. May Allah accept our effort. And I'm aware, brother, there are many things more we can talk. Normally my talk is for 1 hour to 1 hour 15 minutes. Today I requested Brother Zakir to speak for 1.5 and I spoke for 1 hour 40 minutes. And I'm aware that whatever we do research, it's just a drop in the ocean. And for more information, you can refer to my cassettes on concept of God in major religions, Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, the major world religious scriptures, and there are many books I've written on these topics as well on Hinduism. Inshallah, if a person goes through them, they'll get more knowledge on the similarities on Hinduism and Islam. Hope that answers the question.
In Allah's grand scheme of things, each one of us is but a piece of the puzzle. We are vital, but the picture is incomplete.
But if we get together as one, we can make the picture complete. Peace TV gives you the perfect opportunity to complete the picture for your less fortunate Muslim brothers and sisters. By contributing to the United Islamic Aid, a well-organized central Baitul Maal, managed by the Islamic Research Foundation, under my personal supervision, we can change the lives of many Muslims for the better. Our vision is simple. We, inshallah, aim to register 10,000 supporting members of the United Islamic Aid who will make a yearly commitment of a minimum $250, which is 10,000 Indian rupees, or 1,000 Saudi riyal, or an equivalent amount. This will, inshallah, help us yearly collect
$2.5 million,
or
10 crore Indian rupees,
which will help provide education, primary health care, upliftment, and dawah to our less fortunate Muslim brothers and sisters.
To become a supporting member of United Islamic Aid, you and your family members may send your zakat from India to IRF, United Islamic Aid, Development Credit Bank, MMO, Mumbai, India. Account number 001-202-000-0949. SWIFT code DCBLINBB043. From outside India to IRF Development Credit Bank, MMO, Mumbai, India. Account number 001202-000-0126. SWIFT code DCBLINBB043. Please confirm your contribution at UIA@IRF.net. For other queries and clarifications, kindly contact Mr. Manzoor Sheikh on telephone number 00912223736875 or visit our website www.unitedislamicaid.org.
Peace TV, the solution for humanity.
Peace TV.
It seems we have a non-Muslim brother on that mic. Yes, brother.
Yeah.
Can we have your name and your profession so that we get to know your background?
Well, I am Sashank Sekhar from Ranchi, Jharkhand. I am doing my engineering from Satyabhama Engineering College here. Sir, your lecture, after hearing your lecture, our misbelief about Islam and Muslims vanished today. Sir, I have been to Jammu and Kashmir and have seen the trauma and pain that the people are suffering there because of the so-called jihad of some Muslims. Sir, my question is, that does Islam support such activities? If no, then what actually the word jihad means? Is it in accordance with the 56th verse of the 7th chapter of Quran, which says, do not mischief? Or the 40th verse of 42nd chapter, which says, forgiveness is better than retaliation? Or the 32nd verse of the 5th chapter, which states, if anyone killed a person, he kills the mankind. Sir, I have one more question in the same context, and it is that does Islam teaches to give priority to the religion, that is dharma or mazhab, before the country or motherland, that is Matribhumi or Qom? Thanks a lot.
The brother asked you very good questions. The first question is regarding concept of jihad. He says that why are people fighting? He's been to Kashmir. About jihad, does Islam encourage this fighting? What is the meaning of jihad? Does it not disagree with the quotations he gave us? Remind the chapter 5 verse 32. Brother, as far as the word jihad is concerned, there's a misconception not only amongst the non-Muslims, but even among the Muslims. What most of the people think, that any war fought by any Muslim for any reason, whether it be for his personal gain, whether it be for politics, whether it be for language, whether it be for color, it is called as jihad. Jihad does not mean any war fought by any Muslim. Jihad comes from the Arabic word jahada, which means to strive, which means to struggle, like how we have jiddo-jahed. So jihad basically means to strive, to struggle. And in the Islamic context, it means to strive against one's own evil inclination. It also means to strive to make the society better. It even includes to strive in the battlefield to fight in self-defense. Jihad also means to fight against oppression and tyranny. Jihad basically means to strive or struggle. Many people have misconception that jihad means holy war. And many people translate jihad as holy war. The Arabic word for holy war is harbun muqaddasa. If you read the Quran, nowhere in the Quran, not a single verse, nowhere in the authentic hadith of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is this word harbun muqaddasa mentioned anywhere. There's no harbun muqaddasa at all. The translation of jihad is not holy war at all. This word holy war was first used by the historians to describe the crusades of the Christian, who spread Christianity and who killed thousands of people in the name of Christianity. Unfortunately today, many people, including so-called Muslim scholars, inverted commas, they translate jihad as holy war. It's a mistranslation. Yes, jihad means to strive, to struggle. One of the striving can include fighting. Fighting also should be in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that is qital fi sabilillah. Now regarding a question, that why does Islam encourage fighting and killing? And there are many critics of Islam who normally say, Islam is a ruthless religion. It always says that you should kill the non-Muslim wherever you find them. Many critics, including the critic of India, Arun Shuri, and he writes in his book, The World of Fatwa, he quotes Surah Tawbah, chapter number 9, verse number 5, and says that the Quran says, wherever you find a kafir, into bracket Hindu, that you kill them. And if you open the Quran, Surah Tawbah, chapter 9, verse number 5, and if you read, it does say, wherever you find a kafir, you kill. But this is a quotation out of context. For the context, if you read the first few verses, it speaks about a peace treaty between the mushriks of Makkah and the Muslims. If you read Surah Tawbah, chapter 9, first few verses, it speaks about a peace treaty between the Muslims and the mushriks of Makkah. Now, this peace treaty was unilaterally broken by the mushriks of Makkah. By the time Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reaches verse number 5, He gives them an ultimatum to the mushriks, and He tells them, put things straight in 4 months' time, otherwise a declaration of war. And in the battlefield, Allah says that when the enemies come to attack you, you kill the enemies. So this verse is revealed in the battlefield, that when the enemies come to kill you, don't get scared, fight them. But naturally, any army general today, to boost up the morale of his soldiers, he will say that when the enemies come, kill them. He will not say that, just be quiet. And Arun Shuri, after quoting verse number 5, he jumps to verse number 7. Because verse number 6 has the reply. Surah Tawbah chapter 9 verse number 6 says that if the kafir, if the enemy seek asylum, if they want peace, don't just give it to them. Escort them to a place of security. If the enemy wants peace or asylum, escort them to a place of security. Today, the most merciful army general maximum will tell his soldiers that let the enemy go. Here Allah says, don't just let them go, escort them to a place of security. So whenever these verses are there of killing, including the verse of Surah Anfal, chapter 8, verse number 60, when they say that, prepare your steed and be prepared, attack the enemy. The next verse says, but if the enemy is inclined towards peace, you give it to them. So almost all the verses we talk about fighting, after that it says that if they want peace, peace is better. Now, regarding your question, what about the verses of Surah Maida chapter 5, verse 32, Surah Nisa chapter 4, verse 40, that if anyone kills any human being, it's as though he has killed the whole of humanity. This is the basic rule of Islam, that if anyone kills any human being, whether it be a Muslim or non-Muslim, unless it be for murder or for creating mischief in the land, spreading corruption in the land, it is as though he has killed the whole of humanity. And if anyone saves any human being, it is as though he has saved the whole of humanity. Now, if you read Bhagavad Gita, Bhagavad Gita chapter number 2, verse number 50, it says, Shri Krishna tells Arjuna to do jihad, strive. If you read Mahabharat talks about thousands of verses of fighting, thousands of verses, many number of times more than what the Quran speaks. Mahabharat is a scripture, as you may be aware, it talks about a feud, a fight between the Pandavas and the Kauravas. The five brothers Pandavas and 100 brothers Kauravas fight. And Bhagavad Gita is a part of Mahabharat, 18 chapters in which Shri Krishna, Lord, he gives advice to Arjun. Arjun says in Bhagavad Gita chapter number 1, verse 42 to 46, that I would prefer getting killed unarmed rather than fighting my cousins. How can I fight my cousins? The Kauravas, my cousins. I would prefer getting killed unarmed rather than fight. Immediately, Lord Krishna, you know what does he say in chapter number 2? Verse number 2 and 3 says that how could such impure thought come in your mind? It is sinful. How could you become so impotent? How could your heart become so weak? So Lord Krishna says such thoughts are impotent. They are impure. They are sinful. It will prevent you from going to the heavenly planets, going to Jannah. After that, Bhagavad Gita, chapter number 2, verse number 31-33 says, he says, Lord Krishna, he says to Arjun, that it is the duty of a Kshatriya to fight. If he does not fight, he shall not go to heaven. And if you do not fight, you are doing a sin. So if you analyze in Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says that you have to fight. Imagine if I take verses of Bhagavad Gita and say that Lord Krishna tells Arjun that you have to kill your relatives. If I quote out of context, it will be devilish. But in context, it is Lord Krishna says that if you have to fight against falsehood, for the truth, you can fight against anyone, even if it be your relatives. So now in context, it makes sense that if you have to fight for justice, even if it be against your relatives, there's no problem. So that is the message of Bhagavad Gita and Mahabharat, fighting truth against falsehood. The moment I tell a Hindu about Mahabharat and Bhagavad Gita, he has the knowledge. He says, no, but Mahabharat and Bhagavad Gita is a fight between truth and falsehood. That is the same thing what's mentioned in the Quran. So moment I quote to you Bhagavad Gita, Mahabharat, you understand the Quran better. And furthermore, many people say, oh, this Quran talking about jihadis. If you do jihad, if you die, you'll go to Jannah. Many critics, including Arun Shuni, quote. And they quote the even Hadith of Sahih Bukhari, volume number 4, in the book of Jihad, chapter number 2, Hadith 46. It says that a mujahid is a person who strives in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah alone knows who strives. And further, a prophet said that if a mujahid dies in the battlefield, he shall go to Jannah, he will get paradise. But if he returns back, if he does not die, he will return back with the booty of war. This hadith and several verses of the Quran are quoted by the critics of Islam. I wonder how could the Hindu critics quote these things? Haven't they read the Bhagavad Gita? Haven't they read the Mahabharat? Even Shri Krishna, he mentioned in Bhagavad Gita, chapter number 2, verse number 37. O Arjun, O son of Kunti, rise up and fight. Even if you're killed, no problem, you will go to heaven. And if you return back successfully, you will get the good riches of this earthly world. Same thing as the Hadith. So when Krishna says to Arjun that fight, if you're killed, no problem, you will go to heaven. If you return back successful, you will get the riches of the world. That is the same thing what Sahih Bukhari says, what the Quran says. So therefore, you should understand each other better by reading the scripture. So Islam allows fighting as a last resort, in self-defense or to fight against oppression, otherwise no. And jihad means to strive, to struggle. Now coming to your second question, which is more important? Which is more important, following the rules of the country or following the mazhab, the deen? It is like you asking me, who do I belong to first? Do I belong to my father or my mother first? Brother, as far as following the rules of the country and following the rules of deen, Almighty God is concerned, Almighty God is our creator. He is more superior to us. Following the rules of deen is more important for us than any other rule laid down by father, mother. or any country. But I am an Indian. I know there's not a single law in the Indian constitution which prevents any Muslim in India to follow Islam. In fact, India is one of the few countries which is mentioned in the constitution that it is the right, it's the birthright of every citizen of India to preach, practice his religion. That's what I'm doing. There is not a single law in India which prevents me from doing something which is farz or compels me for doing something which is haram. There is no law. I can offer five times salah if I want. If I don't want, I can't offer. There is not a single law in the Indian constitution which prevents me from becoming a good Muslim. Therefore, as far as I'm concerned, I am a very practicing Muslim, alhamdulillah, and also practicing Indian. And it's by definition, by geographical definition, an Indian geographically is called Hindu. So if Hindu means a geographical definition, I am a Hindu living in India, and I'm a practicing Muslim.
Our step.
The responsibility of teaching your children is yours.
Our concern.
And help them to change their lives.
Our approach.
Muslims can get seduced by the non-Muslim world.
The best gift a mother can give to the baby is the breast milk.
Remedy for different issues.
And I'm your host, Uthman Barry. We'd like to welcome you to the program Raising Children.
Get ready to know the real and valid solutions to your problems in raising children tonight at 8 p.m. Saudi Arabia and 9 p.m. UAE on Peace TV.
Tawheed is our way to salvation. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ I have not created jinn and mankind except to worship me. Also Allah says, verily we have sent into every nation a messenger proclaiming worship Allah and shun false deities. To know more about Tawheed, join me, Salim Al-Amiri, only on Peace TV.
Join the institution advocating the oneness of Allah. Join Salim Al-Amiri in Kitab al-Tawheed today at 6 p.m. Saudi Arabia and 7 p.m. UAE on Peace TV. A man, a mission, a world-renowned orator on Islam and comparative religion, he dedicated more than five decades of his life for Dawah. Ahmad Didad.
We Muslims believe that Jesus was the Christ.
This book is an eternal book of guidance for you and for me, for the whole of mankind. It's the solution to the problems of mankind.
The miracle is when you expect a man to be dead and he's alive. That's a miracle.
Man with a Mission, next on Peace TV.
Brother, can I have your name and your profession first, please?
My name is Saravana Kumar. I'm working in your bank. I understood many Hinduism now only because most of the Hindus doesn't know what Vedas is. Do you agree all Vedas scriptures and Vedas chapters, everything, is it correct? Then some section of the people in Hindu only learning that Vedas. Not many Hindus are learning. They are not allowed to learn. But those religion leaders also not practicing the same what Vedas says. Is it correct? Then why they are doing like that? Please answer me. Thank you.
That's a good question. The first question, what do I believe with everything what the Vedas say? Point number two, the Vedas, only a selected few Hindus, learned people, they read. Others are prevented from reading. Why? Point number one, do I believe in everything of the Veda? If you analyze, Allah says in the Quran in Surah Ra'd, chapter number 13, verse number 38, Allah says that we have sent a revelation in every age. Likullin ajlin kitab. In every age we have sent a revelation. By name, only four are mentioned in the Quran. Torah, Zabur, Injil, and the Quran. The Quran is the last and final revelation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which was revealed to the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Now, there was a person who asked me in Bombay also, that can I consider Veda to be the word of God? Do I consider Veda totally to be correct? See, by name, only four are mentioned, Torah, Zabur, Injil, and Quran. But there were many books revealed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, regarding Veda, can I consider it the word of God? Since Veda is not mentioned by name in the Quran or in any authentic hadith, I cannot say for sure that it is the word of God. I can say maybe it is, maybe it is, maybe, maybe not. But even if Veda was the word of God, it was meant for those people and for that time. Today, we have to follow the last and final revelation, that is the glorious Quran for the whole of humankind. Regarding your question, do I believe everything in the Veda? Allah says in the Quran in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 79, فَوَيْلٌ لِلَّذِينَ يَخْتُبُونَ الْكِتَابَ بِأَيْدِهِمْ ثُمَّ يَقُولُونَ هَذَا مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ لِيَشْتَرُوا بِهِ ثَمَنًا قَلِيلًا فَوَيْلٌ لَهُمْ مِمَّا كَتَبَتْ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَوَيْلٌ لَهُمْ مِمَّا يَكْسِبُونَ. Woe to those who write the book with their own hands and then say this from Allah, to traffic with it for a miserable price. Woe to those for what they earn, woe to those for what they write. Now we realize that all the previous scriptures of Almighty God, by the passage of time, they have got corrupted. They have been changed. Today, we don't have the Injil in the pure form. The Bible that we have, it is not the Injil which was revealed to Isa. They have changed in passage of time. So even if Veda was the word of God today, it has not maintained its pure form. And all the Hindu scholars, they agree. So Allah says in Surah Hijr, chapter 15, verse number 9, that we have revealed the Quran and we shall guide from corruption. Quran is also called as the Furqan, the criteria to judge right from wrong. So what I say, that whatever is matching with the Quran in the Vedas, I accept it to be true. What doesn't match, I leave it aside. Because Veda hasn't maintained its pure form according to the Hindu scholars. So what I say, whatever matches with Quran, I say I've got no objection. This part may be the word of God. But I don't agree everything of the Vedas. There are many unscientific points in the Veda. I can give a talk on that, which I don't intend giving. I can give hundreds of unscientific things mentioned in the Vedas. So what I say, that this is the Furqan, the criteria. You check with this. If it matches with this, we agree it to be that part as to be true. Hope that answers the question.
Do we have a question from the sister's side? Do we have a non-Muslim sister who has a question?
Good evening, everybody. I'm Aarti. I'm an engineering student. I believe that most religions are just a set of beliefs. Hinduism is a belief, Islam is a belief, Christianity is a belief. And most major religions like the Islam or the Hinduism or the Christianity have been formed through ages. They have come past through a lot of ages. So there can be a lot of additions and subtractions which can add value to the religion and which can also cause some kind of a demolition to the name of the religion itself. So my question is, why do we have to stick on to few religious books like the Quran or the Vedas to follow a life of our own? Why can't we just take the rights, the positives and the negatives and leave the negatives alone and take the positives of the Quran and take the positives of the Vedas alone and lead a life of good? And no matter what, for example, no matter what the Vedas say or no matter what the Quran says, I believe that a man should have a single wife. And I would definitely not agree upon the fact that the Vedas contain something like that or the Quran contains something like that. It is up to my conscience to leave off the negatives of however great a religious book might be and take the positives of the book alone. And why are we here to even discuss about the differences and similarities between the two great religions? Why can't we just take the postures of both religions and just lead a life of our own?
That's my question. Sisters asked a very good question. A very good question, a very relevant question. That why should we follow religion? Why Hinduism, why Islam, why Christianity? Why not follow the good things of all? And that's it, finish. Who will decide what is good, what is bad? For example, in America, wearing skirts and shorts is common. Western country, it is modest. So for there, wearing skirts and shorts is modest. If you wear in Chennai, if a girl walks on the streets with shorts and skirts, you will call it immodest, including you, sister. Even you say she is immodest. So what is modest in America is not modest here. When I went to America a few years back, there was a person who told me that you Indian woman, you are immodest. I was shocked. Why? How come Indian women are immodest? Because when you wear the sari, you show your belly. So for the American, the woman showing the belly is immodest. So who will decide? If you go to certain Muslim countries, the Arab countries, looking at a woman, staring at a woman is immodest. Here, as long as you don't touch a woman, you can talk to her, you can look at her, it's modest. Therefore, when you greet the Indian, they say namaste without touching. In the Western countries, it is common that you shake hands. So shaking hand between a lady and a man is modesty. As long as you shake hand and don't touch any other part of the body, in some Western countries, it is modest. In other Western countries, kissing a woman on the lips and the cheek is modest. In some Western countries, you can do what you want, the male and the female. As long as you do willingly, it is modest. Who will decide? Who will decide? If you go to America, there are nude beaches. There is a ship I read in the Times of India 2 months back, a nude cruise. Nude. Everyone in the ship will be nude. For them, it is modest. Who will decide? The best person to decide is the Creator, sister. Now, I am asking you, who will decide what is right, what is wrong? Who will decide? And if you say that select the best, I'm with you. I agree with you, sister. Select the best of all the religions. So that's what I've done. I've selected the best from the Vedas. But what is best is not best for you. That's the problem. I'll discuss that also. I challenge any human being to point out a single principle of Islam which is against humanity as a whole. Single. I say, I'm not speaking on behalf of the other Muslims. I'm putting my head on the guillotine. I challenge anyone. Yes, they may be many non-Muslims, may think certain thing is wrong. For example, the sister disagrees with a man having more than one wife. I'll discuss that, inshallah. After I give you the answer, you'll be convinced, inshallah, God willing. You'll be convinced. For example, if you ask a problem, 2 + 2 is how much? If you don't know the answer, I'll give you the answer. Now, once you know the answer, you get convinced. So what do you have to discuss, sister? The things which you don't agree, you can come on the microphone and tell me, I am just a student. I'll try my level best with Allah's help to try and reply. Now, though the Vedas say you can marry more than one wife, the Christian Bible says, the Quran says. Now, you don't believe in all of them, no problem. Let's talk about logic. Sister, do you know, by nature, male and female are born in equal proportion? By nature, male and female are born in equal proportion. But if you ask any pediatrician, a doctor of the children, he will tell you that the female child can fight the germs and diseases better than the male child. So in the pediatric age itself, there are more male children dying as compared to female children. So in pediatric age itself, there are more females than the males. As life goes on, there's death due to cigarette smoking, death due to alcoholism, death due to accident, death due to war. More male are dying as compared to female. So today in the world, there are millions of women more in the world as compared to male. Only in some countries, third world countries like India, the female population is less than the male population. You know why? Because of female infanticide. According to a BBC report, according to Emily Bekenin on the program Let Her Die, the topic was assignment. Every day, more than 3,000 fetuses are being aborted in India after they identified that they're females. That means more than 1 million fetuses are being aborted in India every year after they identified the females. If you stop this evil practice, and according to Tamil Nadu government hospital report, this state of yours, that report says out of 10 female born alive, 4 are put to death. Do you say it is right? It is wrong. If you stop this evil practice, even in India, the female population will become more than the male population. In America alone, there are 7.8 million females more than male. In UK alone, there are 4 million female more than male. In Germany alone, there are 5 million female more than male. In Russia alone, there are 9 million female more than male. God alone knows how many millions of females are more than males in the world. Suppose, sister, hypothetical question. Suppose my sister happens to live in America. Or suppose your sister happens to live in America, USA, and the market is saturated. Every man has found a woman for himself. Yet, there will be 7.8 million females who will not find life partners. Now, only option remaining for them, for these females who have got no life partner, is that either marry a man who already has a wife or become public property. You may say, public property? Brother Zakir, such a harsh word. Sister, it is the most sophisticated word I can use. I cannot use a better word. In America, on average, the statistics tell us a person has 8 different sexual partners before he settles down with one. Mistresses is common. You can have 10, 20, 30, no problem. 100 also. The law will not say anything. If you marry more than one wife, that thing doesn't go down their throat. Why? In mistresses, the woman does not get a right. She's degraded. She's dishonored. In Islam, when you have a second wife, you have to give equal rights. She has the honor. She has respect. But I do agree with you, sister. I agree with you that no woman under normal circumstances would like to share a husband with any other woman. I agree with you, sister. But the basic law of the Islamic Sharia is let a small loss take place to prevent a big loss. Let a small loss take place to prevent a big loss. So all the Muslim women who know that there are millions of women, if they would not allow their husband to have more than one wife, they would become public property. They say, we would not mind sharing a husband to prevent our other sisters to become public property. Hope that answers the question.